take away from all this.
Sprout is pretty good against BKB.
Yeah. It's it's just an amazing spell.
Mm-hmm.
It does really well.
Is that another spell that's going to get nerfed with a flying vision as well?
Maybe not. When I look at Sprout, I don't think that's the issue with Nature's Prophet. I think it wholly comes down to his treants and EG, the OS Rog of all OS Rog heroes. Has he lost yet? I think he's lost one game. He lost the last game.
Mostly been winning. That much.
Yeah, Pilot Dio Spirit in the last game of Na'Vi series.
Yeah.
Because Na'Vi last picked it in game 2 and 1, and then Secret second picked it in game 3, I think.
Yeah. The hero wins a lot. That's commonly understood. And although his win rate wasn't the best at the Shanghai Major, that means nothing. Not to this hero. I mean, you saw Kyo when he was on the panel, right?
Yeah. I mean, every single pro that I've talked to is like, yeah, Earth Spirit's really dangerous. But apparently some teams just feel like some heroes are a little bit stronger. For example, Team Empire not wanting to give the Enigma, right, to Evil Genius is understandable, but means Earth Spirit, as well as the Darkseer, is going to go their way. And we saw the danger of that, the complexity.
The thing about Empire's lineup is you have to anticipate the Earth Spirit being active on the map, because you have to assume that's going to be played by Fear. He is the type of player, as a support, he wants to be active. When you play a core role and you come into the support role, you're never turning into the 5 position. I think any player that played mid or carry that transitions always plays the 4 role, because they know how to gank.
Yeah.
And that's what Fear is essentially going to want to do with this hero. And I think it was Mood that said it at the panel in Shanghai. He says, at some point this hero does fall off to a certain extent, so you want to be as active as possible.
It's not like you're a bounty with a track to fall back on for kills here and there. You do have to do stuff early on, but similar situation to what Complexity had, potential dual lane. With a Chen, you're leaving a deficit in your lanes, you know, for the first, let's say, 30 seconds to a minute, at the very least, depending on which route you want to go with Chen. That double Ion Shell, initial stages, Complexity completely crushed.
Yeah.
So how do you shore up your lanes then against the Earth Spirit Darkseer combination? You can't get something that is an obvious clear counter, like the Oracle that has been banned away by EG. So how do you fix this potentially dangerous scenario for Team Empire?
It's just kind of going to suck, because the one downside of Chen is you know that he's not really going to be able to help out in the first two levels, and that's where Darkseer thrives. You're just going to get a few levels, get aggressive on the map, push the lane as far as you can, and if the Earth Spirit decides to rotate over, the Chen pretty much has to play a guessing game. So Warding Vision is pretty paramount. On top of that, your first few ganks really have to work out. Turn to pick.
Klinks as well as Sven going to be taken out of the pool by Team Empire. Is it worth considering, by the way, the OD safe lane if you're dealing with some kind of aggressive scenario like Earth Spirit Darkseer?
I don't think so. I feel like the OD in this game in particular should probably be used, just because he can have a free setup for the Chen. And it is hard to gank an OD. If you mess up, he has a wand, a bracer, treads. It's pretty hard to cut through that.
Right. And if the Earth Spirit's going to be spending a lot of time in top lane, it does mean that mid space is a bit more opened up. There's the Lion. Not terribly surprising to seeing that one. Kind of makes up for perhaps some of Chen's weaknesses. And we talked about it on the panel. Was it QO that mentioned it? The way that like Team Secret roaming jungler mixed in with a nice farming support, such as Lion that has a high impact in mid game, late game.
Yeah. Curious to see what EG decide to pick as a cores, how far they deviate from their strategy at the Shanghai Major. Although, they didn't do bad, third place, but I feel like for them, that was a disappointment and they would make some adjustments. Some of the core heroes that we saw them play there, Sven, Ursa, I think those are the two most prominent carries, and now you've got an Invoker almost immediately. I know for a fact that Sumel's the Invoker player. Anybody who uses legacy keys like Artur will never play Invoker.
Yeah, that's no longer a thing.
What's wrong with legacy keys on Invoker?
It's awful. I use legacy keys. It's so hard. It's like D-F-E-Y.
Oh, yeah, it's spread all over your keyboard.
It's way too complicated.
Yeah, forget that.
10 seconds remaining.
So in which case, a Lion paired up with... Remaining. What kind of melee core can you actually run against a Earth Spirit Darkseer dual lane?
That is really hard to answer, just because that lane
Juggernaut?
Does quite a lot. Jug does okay.
Yeah.
I think Jug actually does... I think Jug does okay against the Darkseer, even one-to-one. Like, you're gonna trade farm, essentially.
Good call. I guess then you've got the healing ward as well with Jhen for the sustained pushes in.
Yeah, because Empire is gonna want to get aggressive in a game like this. They have very aggro heroes. And Evil Geniuses, the later their game goes, if you notice that the type of lineup that they have, it's really hard to catch any of those heroes. And I don't think Empire have the best gap closers. Eventually your Lion will get a blink, but he's probably gonna be the 5 position this game. And OD is kind of in a similar spot, same with Jug. Jug's not one of those cores that can just hardcore pressure you, like, say, an Ursa can.
So do you look to pick up your secondary support here for Evil Geniuses?
I think you can get away now that Empire has kind of played the game where they take their core first. Think Ursa's pretty good here, if you want to take it, since Sven is all banned out.
And not risk getting it banned.
Hmm?
And not risk getting it banned in the final.
Yeah, exactly. Because normally, you want to wait for them to pick their one position first, so that
right.
you can kind of see how you're going to play around it.
I'm down with the Ursa. What about the support then for EG? Can you consider a Crystal Maiden, or is that just too dangerous? It's something that answers the Chen, right?
Oh, hello. Man, you are just...
Pa-pa-pa-pa!
You're on
all
fire,
over the
man.
Place.
Back-to-back. An Empire, they're definitely going to ban the one position. What's left over for Arteezy? Lycan is okay against the Jug, just because you can snipe the healing ward. Still think the Ursa is maybe the best one left.
I mean, Gyro is potentially there, but against a Juggernaut Omni Slash, you
don't
necessarily
like
want to be going into that.
If you want to secure late game, and you probably can if you take a hero like Spec, or I think Spec or Ursa is the way that I would go.
And then for Empire, it's a Ghost Tick hero, finally. He played a lot of Brood on Tornado.
I believe Complexity mentioned that they like Juggernaut versus Spectre, though. So.
Yeah. It works pretty well, just because the ultimate works well, the healing ward sustains against the Radiance. It's pretty nice. Because
okay.
you always need something to... If the Spec decides to go for that route,
yep.
you need something that can sustain.
See, my immediate thought was like, what about Spectre ultimate versus the Omni Slash, but... I guess there are more consistent factors that play into the Juggernaut's
yes.
favor, right?
Beastmaster final pick?
BM is pretty good here. I actually do like Beastmaster here.
Ghostick is a Brood player, but I don't see Brood working against, you know, Docks, yeah.
Yeah. I think the one downside of that is maybe the CM hurts you a little bit.
Mm.
If you want, like, teamfight, you could go for something like the Tide and go straight down, but it might be a little bit redundant.
Oh, yeah, you can just Frostbite the boss, can't you?
Yeah.
It would be dangerous against, I mean, you have the Stun Silence combination of Earth Spirit, but are we set on this being an Exord or a Quaswex Invoker?
I think it should be... Quaswex isn't bad against this lineup, especially against Chen and Lion.
Mm. And doesn't a Quaswex Invoker play better against a Tide Hunter?
Yeah.
So...
We don't know if it's going to be Tide last pick, though. It's
yeah.
still pretty open. Like Durka said, Beastmaster's not a bad alternative here, although... depending on what you pick as your safe laner, you can really abuse that. There's Batrider too if they play it.
Oh yeah, Batrider would be nice.
I gotta decide fast though.
Beastmaster it is. Good call, Durka. Evil Geniuses now. Now do you see the Beastmaster? Does that less incentive for the Lycan? More incentive for a hero like Spectre?
Spectre Ursa.
Okay.
I think if it wasn't a Beastmaster, you would have taken the Ursa. But because it's a Beastmaster, Beastmaster does really well against Ursa. It burns all the mana really quickly. The laning phase isn't even that bad because you can kite.
Right. Thoughts on predictions?
Series or game? Or both?
Just stick with the game.
I think EG's with it.
I think so too, but... I think there's a little bit of bias because I think they're the better team.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
I think
that's why I wanted to hear game, just because you're purely going off of or a little bit more purely off of the draft.
I'm still laughing at when Toby said, "I don't even care what secret draft they got this."
Did you really say that? I didn't hear
yeah.
it. Do you remember that? Please tell me someone outshotted that.
All right, we'll give Toby his opportunity to respond because it's going to be Toby and Malk who are going to be doing the casting for this series.
Obviously, it doesn't matter what Blitz says, because EG's gonna win.
I mean, I had a good little laugh over that one. I actually missed that one. Did you actually say that?
Yeah, it was...
Oh, Topes.
Come on! Can I not make a joke? Obviously, I cannot.
A joke? I think you meant it, too.
Dude, every joke has an element of truth to it.
That's true. You're a good Dota player. That was an underhanded compliment.
That was a fish slap is what that one was. EG versus Empire is what we're here to do and not just completely, like, destroy each other. EG, fun draft to start with. Empire, they look really strong and they're going to have to test their strength right now as EG move into the top rune, and this is actually going to be a battle for first the top rune. The ball flying in right now from Fear. The sun strikes on the way. Aloha Dance. Samael will claim that first blood. The Beastmaster was capable of taking out that bottom rune, while it was the OD who actually took the top. So even though EG do get first blood, they do give up both runes.
All right, so I'm glad this bounty rune phase is over now, so we can preempt the game by saying EG has a very EG-risk lineup. This is something that plays into their comfort zone. Fear is an absolute beast on the Earth Spirit. This is something he's been practicing a ton before Shanghai as well. And I'm really excited to, if we have to see Earth Spirits, I do want to see the highest level. And I think Fear is probably one of the best players in the world, has been for 10 years now.
Yeah, so, he was really impressive at Shanghai. His timings, his synergy as well. It wasn't just the fact like his rotations were great. It was the fact that he worked with every single one of his laners.
Exactly, that excites me a lot. And then there's Universe on the dark side. He actually doesn't like to play the hero, but they pick it for him anyways when they want to win, right? So this is clearly PVD also probably being a bit frustrated with the fact that they went out sooner than they would have liked in Shanghai.
It's the same combo. Like, it's actually exactly the same combo. We were expecting the teams not to, like, bring in something bold and new. Hello, FN. Being initiated on. Just spins himself out. Fear can't really properly initiate on this one. Universe gonna have a little bit of space created with a Aloha Dancer stun on him. But they're being very active on this top lane. I'm expecting Fear to be iron shot up by Universe and then just move over to do something about this jungle.
I think Fear is just gonna create sufficient space to Universe to get the necessary levels early on, and then eventually the Soul Ring. They are ready for it though, and there's actually... It's hard to do it into the tower, I think.
Yeah. Even with a vision behind the tower, which this Observer Ward grants them. Like, diving underneath Lion. Lion has proven that he is, like... one of the, if not the, top support go-to hero right now.
Yeah.
Like, having both a stun as well as a Hex at level 2.
Yeah, talking about their lineup, like, the analyst desk was saying, if you were to look away from which team is playing the lineups and you just looked at them on their own merit, I think Empire's lineup is incredibly strong. It complements each other really well. Like, Beastmaster Chen is a very old combo, especially with the Juggernaut on top of that. They have sufficient disable for the late game in Lion and Beastmaster, one of which goes through BKB. And then they have one of the most popular metagame carries right now with the Outworld Devourer. So a very well-rounded lineup from Empire. At the same time though, EG's also a strong lineup, but...
Oh, here they go. They're going after Yoku right now with a Cold Snap. He has to self-imprison himself. Invoker. Well, here comes your Sunstrike. A little bit off on the timing there from Samael, but it's still not going to change the result. But this is now a 2-0 in favor of EG with another kill.
Honestly, probably not even needed the Sunstrike either. Well, clearly they didn't since it missed.
It's just like that extra insurance, maybe.
Yeah, it's all good.
Well, goodbye, Beastmaster. I was just like, wow, really, Arteezy and PPD combined together. It's not really the lane you're expecting to have another kill on. Speaking of that, top lane, FN, the kick flies out, Universe can't keep the pressure on. They're actually smoking into mid. Yoku's imprisonment is going to allow them to set up in a perfect stun from Aloha Dance. On a Samael, the troll trap followed up by the Centaur. Just perfect combinations from the Chen of Empire.
Look at the level gain on EG, though. PvD is actually higher level than Arteezy's right now.
But it's the Crystal Maiden.
Yeah, exactly.
It's an unchecked Crystal Maiden as well. She's doing whatever she wants on that bottom lane and inside the jungle, and the kill over onto like the offlane and Ghosticks.
There's not a lot of Crystal Maiden players in the world, which is why it makes it very easy to say that PvD is probably the best.
Really nice fear. They're trying to bait Aloha back into that Sunstrike, not lucky enough for it. And Yoku with the rotation up fear. Well, it was nice he stole the Arcane Rune. But Aloha Dance kept him there just long enough that they were able to get the pick off on the Earth Spirit.
Something Fear's really good at is rolling, the rolling boulder. He's very on point with it, regardless of the distance.
Okay, so we were talking about this during the drafting phase. You're running a Crystal Maiden over on EG.
As you say that, Fear's rolling in middle lane.
Is he? Defensive imprisonment, Yoku. Can you get away in time? He's got a Fairy Fire available. And now with the extra help, Penitent slowing down Fear. He's going to boulder himself up. So they do find the kill. Funny thing was, it actually came from the Invoker. Potentially, he could have bouldered himself away to safety. So it's a one-for-one trade-off, but it's OD now dying twice in the space of 5 minutes.
It's worth it, definitely.
Now, I want to get back to the point of Crystal Maiden. So PPD's getting a hell of a lot of farm. We were worried about him being squishy or too slow to the fight. Obviously, too slow to the fight's not the case because they were able to team up together with a Spectre to kill off the Beastmaster. But will he be able to survive Team Empire when they start switching their lanes up? Because currently the only rotations are affecting the mid.
I mean, he's getting level and farm, but it's at the cost of Beastmaster getting the same thing. Like, he's 5.5 already. You could have potentially zoned him out of the lane and not given him experience. But Peter values the level on the Maiden, especially because that means that he can also run around and help out the lanes elsewhere. And of course, the Arcane Aura benefits especially the Darkseer. Well, maybe not so much when he has the Soul Ring.
Every little bit counts. Universe also was... Like, he hit the perfect timing, and this is just that presence of mind to leave the top lane when Empire were trying to go for a hunt. Now it's middle lane, where Fear initiates over on Yoku, the pullback, but another defensive disruption makes it difficult. The Sunstrike, this time the timing is going to be a lot better with the Force Spirit there. Zamal gets the kill, but Aloha Dance, huge control, and the nukes coming out from Chen cannot be underestimated. They're able to get the revenge, but Fear balls away. He actually wants to take the rune from them as well, turns around to pick it up, and Empire will not try and chase.
Yeah, so EG has to be slightly concerned with the fact that, well, there's not much they can do about it because it is a Chen, but he's gonna hit 6 with this creep camp. He already has his Arcane Boots. It's not because he's played a more farm-oriented Chen than a lot of the other Chens that we've seen throughout the day and been used to seeing in Shanghai as well. It's just that he's been participating in these kills, been getting the hits on them as well. He's actually been in all 4 kills that is on the side of Empire. So that's just a huge gold gain and of course experience gain as well. So that's going to mean that he's going to catch his stride a lot earlier than we're used to seeing.
Mm-hmm. He's still got the issue that he's going up against a hero like a Crystal Maiden who can just take out one of his creeps inside of a fight.
That and the Darkseer is going to be level 7 and 8 before any tower pushing is going to happen. And that alone makes it incredibly difficult to push in. They do have the healing ward though to sort of negate it.
Expect a 4-man fight with an extra Sunstrike on top. Obviously the fourth one coming in being Arteezy once he's ready just to haunt himself up. They're preparing for this top lane. Universe now has that level 7, so the level 4 Iron Shell is available. He's a little bit too far away from it. But the Observe Ward's about to time out, and in fact, they go for the D Ward at the last second of that OBS. But the pressure's still on that top tower. The Dire Observe Ward, which was placed, it was actually a fantastic movement from Aloha. After they failed to kill off Fear, they put down the Observe Ward, and it tells them exactly where Fear is standing. He'll have to know he's being watched by an Observer Ward, and this completely cancels the aggression that EG had plans for on the top lane.
Yeah, they might actually push the top tower now. EG is already backing off. The Midas is up on Sumail. He's going to use it right away. So there's no Midas to take away a Chen creep should they choose to defend the top tower. The healing ward has already been put down. I think he... Is EG... Nah, they're not going to give it up. You see Fear TPing in now. Spectre is of course ready with the haunt.
They smoke a long way back. That was out of range of the Dire Observer Ward, so Universe and Fear can get a little bit closer.
Yeah, and Empire is immediately going to back off again. They know that the healing ward will now be on cooldown, so they don't have that to actually work with in the fight, which... means a lot because you need that extra healing going up against just something as simple as the Iron Shell.
I'm wondering if Beastmaster was also considering coming up. That's one thing which I'm looking towards Ghostick, who doesn't have a TP scroll on him. Like everything else is going into what looks to be like a straight Necro build. He's had such a great off lane that Necro is quite a good item choice for him.
Yeah, at this point he really doesn't want to move from the lane because he's actually being allowed to farm. He's over halfway there to the first book of Necromicon. Just by all means, fine on the offlane Beastmaster.
Yeah. Like, when you're only 300 gold behind the hard carry of EG, and you're the offlaner of Team Empire, like, you're feeling great. Every single core of Team Empire is ahead of their opposite. But overall net worth wise, it's still only 50.
Indogra's definitely ahead of the OG.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, sorry. EG is ahead. Under attack. Swing the grubs the other way around. Alright, so EG, they now start their movement, Samal moving over. It's right underneath the hawk of Team Empire, so they're very much aware of what's going on. At the same time, Aloha Dance moves down the bottom lane. He's got Finger of Death. So with the Roar initiation, they should have enough follow-up damage to kill off RTZ here. Finger will have to be committed to ensure the kill, but it's still a quick and efficient rotation from Team Empire. While EG look for a gank in the mid, it's not going to come out, however. They might be able to pick up a couple of these Cheng creeps. In fact, they only get one of them, and that's not the trade-off you were looking for a Death of a Spectre.
It's all right. It's sort of unavoidable to survive through a BM Lion gank.
It's just you don't want to lose that tower as well. The catapult currently is killing it off, and they're going for the kill. Sphere, I mean, going to ball himself over towards the Aloha Dance. The slow is going to be enough that the Sunstrike from Samael is capable of hitting.
RTC actually manages to get in there the last second and get the urn charges.
Also gets him back on the lane.
Bottom tower though. It's actually Quillbore that got the last hit on it as well.
So Beastmaster gets even more money, and that is his Necro book. So we get 11 minutes, he gets Necro 1.
Yeah, and it's this Death Ball that is so fearsome. I mean, Darkseer handles it pretty well, especially in conjunction with Invoker, but I don't think Crystal Maiden can... He hasn't even skilled Freezing Field, so let's not even get into that.
Yeah. He's all about the control and the fights.
Look at the farm on the Chen. He has his Arcane Boots, and he is 250 gold off the mechanism.
Can Empire just then deathball it?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, as long as they stick together, Spectre isn't gonna do much. He doesn't really have... He has face boots, but he has the standout early game Spectre build that can't do much against the lineup of Empire if they stick together. They're gonna go for...
Is it an Envy kill or is it Roshan?
I mean, it's they could definitely a Roshan attempt.
Okay.
When you gather five heroes like that in a smoke, getting Roshan is much better than just trying to get one kill.
EG have no information on this, however. Like, you could let a Sunstrike off from Samael. That would be an option.
Well, it's especially tricky because the Juggernaut is still farming on the top lane. Normally, that would be one of the heroes that you would want at the Rose Pit.
The pings are coming now, but it's too late. The damage is done. Empire has Roshan.
Yeah, and you didn't have honed up on the Spectre either, so there was no response from EG. They couldn't even have the Spectre farm the side lane and just... TP in when they needed it.
Man, Aloha Dance can be so happy too. It's a 12-minute blink dagger up for this lion. The initiation is going to go through the roof. PBD runs in. They manage to find OD, but the kick's going to miss. A defensive imprisonment again, messing up with the timing here of EG. As Empire, all there. There's your blink fall to a double stun. The Finger of Death and the double centaur stun. Universe and PPD. They just evaporate under the Empire attack. And FN into the spin. Fear. He didn't ball himself far enough away. He's been body blocked up. Have they got enough damage? Yes, they do with the last tech in from Chen. And Samel's going to go down as well. Team Empire, not only will they take four heroes, they're taking that tier one tower to boot.
Toby, that escalated quickly.
I would agree.
And that is just the strength of this lineup. Like, they're just gonna punish them so hard for whatever kills they can pick up at this time, and they might already have extended their lead so much that it'll be almost impossible for EG to have a response to it, especially because the Spectre's not gonna really offer much against this lineup. They're gonna get a Drum of Endurance eventually, but...
He's still gotta keep up with a Juggernaut who's gonna have a Battle Fury pretty soon. Like, the amount of money injected into Team Empire is ridiculous.
We're actually seeing a tournament where Spectre's
just
don't
perform. Hold in. Here comes Fear. Gets the kick over on two. Turns on the Magnetize. The Juggernaut's the primary one that has to stay alive here. He gets the spin. Backing out. And then Ho-D drops down the hammer. Fear's on the run out of here. Is he getting enough damage? The Juggernaut actually did get picked off by the Sunstrike of Samael. And Universe looking to try and turn this one around. There is the stun onto PPD. Clean up the Chen army. They made it very difficult for EG to chase this out. But that Sunstrike from Samael makes this really, like, a lot better fight for EG. Yeah, even if they did lose the spec.
The only reason it even went even in this case was because of that Sunstrike. Well, Chen also lost all of his creeps, so that's something. That'll buy them some time. Not a whole lot. But getting that Juggernaut was actually very essential for that fight to go even. It was on point as well. Wasn't even close.
Okay, so
Samael is, by all means, farming great. 105 CS. Closest on the Empire side of things is 84 on the Juggernaut. Samael has 6 kills to his name. Almost completing that Yule set, but already sitting on a Midas and the Drum of Endurance. Takes another tower.
FN.
Actually takes the first tower for EG.
FN's gonna be really careful up here. He just used Spin and then instantly gets kicked. Sunstrike's on his way again! And that's gonna be a very dead FN. PPD will take the last hit on this one. And now, a lot of pressure will be applied to that tier 1 tower. Universe can just creep skip it out. And Empire's looking for an opening elsewhere. But they're being watched by PPD Delusions.
Mechanism up on Darkseer as well, which is very important for them to be able to fight up against Empire's lineup, but very squishy supports other than that. PPD and Fear don't really have any items to show.
A Universe's mech in that last mid fight was actually what allowed EG to keep their fight going.
And this early Blink Dagger alongside the level 11 Beastmaster now. Oh, he actually, there's Book 2 flying in now, so he has Necromicon level 2. It just really gives complete map control to Empire where they want it. And the only response for EG is basically counteracting wherever Empire goes, that's where we won't go.
Yep. Just go for the trade-off, try and force down the other buildings.
Exactly, they're just gonna find themselves at the opposite end of the map wherever Empire is pushing, and the sad part about this is they're gonna get a tier 1 and Empire's gonna get a tier 2, and they might even go knocking on the base door.
Yeah. They might do some damage to the tier 3 tower.
Remember, they have an Aegis as well, and Chen is coming in now with Mechanism, also a point booster.
But the main man's missing again. FN is not with the rest of his team. He's still trying to finish up this battle for you.
They're gonna meet up and take down that tier 2 tower that's already on 500 HP.
Makes sense. Where is the rest of his money, by the way? Like, he's had this Perseverance for a while. I actually thought he had, for some reason, I thought he had more money. Now he picks up the Claymore.
He has a Claymore, but he just died twice. A lot of momentum was taken away from the Juggernaut. He didn't get to farm off while, like, they do the successful push. And normally he could then go back to a lane, take 4 creep waves or something, and really just have a very well-timed battle fury. Instead, he dies these 2 times, one of them TPing back into the lane. That's definitely cost them dearly. I think they should just continue pushing.
They're backing up instead. How long have they got left on the... Alright, so even with the Aegis Immortal, it lasts for another 10 seconds.
Yeah.
So there's no reason to take the risk. You've just removed almost all the outer towers of evil geniuses.
There is a Necromicon 3 now on the Beastmaster. 17 minutes in offlane Beastmaster. It's a pretty good timing, I'd say.
It's very, very good timing. Like, in combination with, like, Lohar Dancer's timing, everything for Empire kind of hasn't been denied. Like, the only thing which has been delayed is the Battle Fury from the Juggernaut. And I'm only gonna say delayed. This Aghanim Scepter from the Chen is only 2,000 gold. Like, this is the result of so many outer towers being lost by EG.
Yeah, and you can see the resolve in Empire's strategizing here as well. They don't want to give EG anything. They put down these aggressive wards in the lane, so they keep tabs on wherever EG will go on their own half of the map. So essentially, the only lane that EG feels comfortable staying in, or can even feel comfortable staying in, is the top lane. And that means that they have all their heroes standing around their own top tier 2 tower just waiting to smoke up behind RTZ, using him as bait.
Empire are so defensive. They're letting the Chen army take care of the mid lane.
I mean,
so
they
push
know
will
there's
stop
a smoke
there.
Gang coming, right? They have these 2 wards in the lane, so they know there's no one farming from EG on either of those lanes, so where can they be? Obviously, they'll have to be in the top lane.
Yep. And that's why Lohar and FN are moving into the safer camps to farm up.
All smoked out, obviously. Yeah.
Yeah. And RTZ, like, he's still continuing this farm game of his. And by the looks of it, he's building into what I can only assume is going to be a mana style. Or is it worthwhile getting an earlier Diffuser Blade? Obviously, you want to have the two the paired up together.
In this case, I think the... Well, it's a toss-up, really. I think the mana style, he needs survivability, basically. I think he's blown up way too fast with the Mensa style. So just getting the Yasha right now into a Mensa style.
Yeah, that'll make sense. Aloha's on the hunt. This Chen army has taken this creep wave from the tier 2 tower in mid, almost the tier 3 tower on EG's side. And now EG try and force the issue. Pushing up through the top, and Empire are actually not in a great position to get a trade off. Like, FN's taking a lot of farm down the bottom lane, the mid lane's pushing in, so if EG do want to try and force the issue here, they will be losing out.
Oh yeah,
and Sen, they actually send the Spectre home, and he can horn himself back into the fight if they want to.
Exactly, but by the time EG is knocking on that tower, it's all too late for Empire to actually react to it. It's already half HP, you have the Fort Spirits hitting it as well. If Empire wanted to
respond to this, they're gonna do this. Aloha's too far away though. The big TP's come back. Gosek's very early triggered off that Necro book, so he's gonna have to turn the units around to try and fight for the rest of his team. And, well, they're actually TPing out. The Sunstrike perfectly on the mark on top of Aloha Dance. The reality in, the Hand of God's being triggered, but Aloha Dance will not be able to survive through this. And the TP out from FN came very early on, so the Juggernaut wasn't there to help out his teammate, and they might get more. Chasing after Ghostix, they have a stun, they have damage, they actually have the Yule Scepter up from Invoker, and the kick coming in from Fear. The mark.
It's incredibly important they get the Beastmaster kill as well, because only getting the Lion would probably result in Empire either going for Roshan, which just respawned, and there would be no Haunt for them to follow up with. So essentially, you would have wasted Haunt for a single kill on a support hero, but that would ruin your momentum for the next 2 minutes. So getting that Beastmaster kill as well is so important.
Yeah, they buy a lot of space. Also, the extra money that went into Fear, it's bringing a little bit closer that Veil of Discord of his. But Empire's going, also hitting a very nice spot. Like Yoku, he's now finished up that BKB over on the OD. It's very difficult, if not impossible, for EG to control him during the fight.
Yeah, but the good part in EG's lineup is they have such potent 5-on-5 right now, especially if they get that Veil of Discord. Search from the Darkseer into Magnetize, and of course, if Peter gets off a Freezing Field. He's built a Bracer, I believe he'll go for a Glimmer Cape. It's just one of those items that he benefits Maiden a lot, right?
Mm-hmm.
Being able to invis yourself while you're using Freezing Field. Another Aegis going down to Empire, and this is where they want to now break base. This is the Aegis that they're going to try and close out the game with, or at least put them two racks up against EG.
Well, they got a couple of options, be it down through the mid or up through or down through the bottom. But Team Empire still have this issue, and EG know it. Like, they move themselves up to this top lane, force the pressure on, so at least Empire, they have to move one hero up to defend this. It's not like they've got themselves a Spectre. A hero can be back on the just defending the lane, and then reality into the fight. Empire do not have this option.
Yoki has actually farmed up a Storm since his 1-3 start. He's 3-3 now, has the Black King bar and the Drum of Endurance on an additional 1300 gold, so he's tanky already. The Aegis over to the Juggernaut, knowing that he's probably the squishiest of the targets right now.
I found an issue, a solution to the split push. The Black Dragons are now up for the Chen. He finished up his Aghanim Scepter.
Very good timing as well.
22 minutes. It seems like Empire are not denied any of their timings by EG.
Yeah, I think EG needs like the perfect execution of their combo to withstand this push. Also because, like, look at the creeps that the Chen was lucky to pick up. The Ancient Granite Golem and the Ancient Black Dragon. The two dream creeps to have so much additional HP gain.
It's all the life, it's the easy push. And he can let the creeps do it in, like, by themselves and then pull them in. So that actually does give the answer to how do you defeat the split push, or at least the lane momentum that EG is able to build.
Ideally, he gets the Alpha Wolf as well. He ran right past one, so he's probably content with the combo he has right now with the Swiftness Aura and then a Troll Waller to lock down a target. It's not a bad thing either. I just really like getting that Alpha Wolf for the additional damage.
How you actually get rid of this? Because right now the mid lane's pushing in so much that EG must commit one hero to defend this. But you lose your tier 2 tower as the trade-off.
Oh, there's no way EG's gonna defend a tier 2 tower, because if they lose that fight, they essentially lose the game.
Yeah.
Then it's over, right? They have to either have to buy back on all their heroes that dies, or they'll just lose Raxus.
Speaking of buyback, Arteezy does not have his. He's ready to haul himself into the fight. So if he can find a couple of pickoffs in the fight, it will work for him. And Smell actually expends his buyback to pick up this Aghanim Scepter. Arteezy may consider the same thing if he can find a little bit more gold to get that Mantra of his.
There's no saving gold. Like, EG is not in a position where they can allow themselves to not buy off items in order for them to save for buyback. They need to commit to items to be able to withstand this push and have a fighting chance.
Oh, they've already lost that tier 3 tower. Here comes the Spectral Horn. Is there going to be a reality in? Currently, no. Well, in fact, all the illusions are just picked up and Arteezy will walk back in. But they're being watched so closely. Like, there's a Hawk just sitting almost next to the tier 2 tower. The Omni Slash PPD tanks every single slice. And they're losing Rax. PPD will buy back. Universe, there's your back. Two-man wall, but Yoku turns on the BKB. They just go in deeper, but Yoku drops down the ultimate. There's too much damage. PPD, there'll be a dieback for him. As the rest of EG bail out, they're going to lose this top rack. The kick's coming in from Fear, trying to slow down the attack. Same with the... Okay, Sunstrike. Nah, FN's still inside the spin. He's okay. He's low on life. He's also got the Aegis Immortal, so he doesn't care if he pops that early on.
He still hasn't died. The healing ward is going. Arteezy finally picks it up.
Wow, that's a better position with another VAC coming in from Universe. The follow-up kick from Fear. And this Chen not looking too good. Already on the sidelines. Juggernaut back into the world of the living and will TP spin himself back to base. He's also done his wonderful backstroke.
So, I mean, objective defended for EG. They lost the base tower. Their range barracks is down to 168.
Yes, PPD, Juggernaut is bugged. This is the backstroke bug. This happens when you Omni Slash. It seems to happen more when you do it into the Radiant base and you go up the hill and then instantly into a spin.
His Blade Fury was also upside down. It looked like the London Eye.
Yes, exactly like that. There's no way to fix that. This is even... Okay, that's not cool. It doesn't fix the animation bug.
It's a hero that is already annoying to deal with, so not being able to click him as well. I remember the old Bounty Hunter model. Oh, Jesus, playing up against that was the worst.
I'll just be happy he's not Arc Warden.
So the
even though I am assured it is possible at a higher level to play against Arc Warden.
Is this because everyone has to leave that the Empire guys are leaving as well? Do they actually care whether... Oh, well, I guess for Chen...
Well, if the Empire guys can't click him as well...
Yeah, for Chen that matters. Not so much for the rest of them. Well, as I say that, OD as well.
Defensive imprisonment, yeah. Oh, we'll see if it'll correct the bug for him. If not, it's going to be a tricky situation, and FN has another advantage in this game. As opposed to his large amount of farm that he's already managed to accumulate.
That's life.
Yeah, I hate to break it to you, PBD, but yeah, that was not going to work.
Maybe you let us kill you.
That will actually correct it.
A tall order.
He actually has to die in order for this to correct.
FN must die.
Even his mant illusions are doing the backstroke.
So now a blink dagger added, there's an Aetherlince and Lion blink dagger on the OD. What does Chen have sitting on 1100 gold? Did he die in that exchange? I don't think
he did.
Yes, he did. Did he die?
Yeah, okay. He got picked off.
Beastmaster having something flown in. Beastmaster finishing up a hood. And of course, Juggernaut with the Mantis style.
And Empire getting such great high ground items. When they come into this EG fight, they're going to be a lot more resistant to both the magical as well as the physical damage EG's looking to pump out.
There is a 16 Invoker with an Aghanim Scepter. And of course, the Veil of Discord on an Earth Spirit. I'm sure they would like to get 11 on him, though. They have 11 on PBD, but because he died and bought back in that fight, that basically took away his entire economy. I think he was sitting on 1300 gold before they were pushing.
Yeah.
And now he opted to buy all the brace instead. He realized...
coming in mid. There's the ball, the perfect back. Aloha Danzig caught out, and he will drop. The BKB from Yoku will end up protecting him.
The thing is, you say, I guess it was the perfect rag. It couldn't really have been done better on the two targets, but there was a BKB on the Admiral Devourer. So this means in 35 seconds from now, Empire's gonna push down the middle lane because they just committed 3 ultis to this.
Yeah. So you just wait out the BKB, and the Eclipse just came back off cooldown as well for the OD. But like, even with this mid-push, like PPD, they want to attack to the tier 2 tower, but look up on the top lane, our wonderful Juggernaut pops the Mana Style, and now does this... Okay, that's actually really cool. Spin out of the top lane. Are they even get? No. There's no initiation. Odie does have the blink into imprisonment, but the rest of Vampire's too far away. And they're also being watched by the Observer Ward of EG. But yeah. This is almost like... Roshan, by the way, has a very quick spawn time. It's going to happen like 22 seconds into the 3 potential minutes. So Team Empire will have that going for them as well.
I don't think Empire feels like they need to. Not at present time. There's still... Well, there's only 30 seconds left now on the Darkseid Ultimate. Magnetar's going to be back up. 45 seconds on Haunt. We'll see. They're not in a position to. Chen was spending way too much time because he wanted that Ancient Granite Golem. And I completely understand him. 15% additional HP on all of your heroes is just way too good to...
Mm-hmm. Well, Team Empire ready to go again. Like, it's the top lane, though. Like, they're forced in the mid lane. Universe did a great job. Like, he just TP'd himself back off that top lane, but he pushed all the way up to this point. So, EG have momentum on their side lane.
I think it's more of Empire just wanting to contain EG in their base and not allowing them to farm anything. They can take whatever goes into their base, but that's it. You're not going to get anything in the jungle.
EG smoke out.
Yeah.
They're coming out to contest Empire. Empire had to move the OD down the bottom lane because they were losing their tower. Aloha Dance will be the man. Oh no! He blinks away. Somehow thought he had the initiation. Now he'll turn around. Gosix gets the Necro Book off. And well, where is that damage, Gosix? The Hand of God's going to repair a lot of it. Chen dying inside the Roche Pit. PPD's going to let it go, but the roll will cancel. The Sunstrike, the back again, is going to pull him away from the Sunstrike, but still the Magnetize controlling up both the Lion as well as the Beastmaster. Three quick heroes for EG to pick off, and look at that timer. Roshan is going to be up in about 20 seconds. EG can take this tier 1 and tier 2 tower in bottom lane. They may not be able to take more, however, with the pressure of the Juggernaut.
If they scout it out. There's a full minute on Necromicon, and Beastmaster isn't going to do much without it. That's almost the same as on his Primal Roar, so they have that 1 minute to play with. There is a Juggernaut pushing in on the top lane, though. So Artesi is back, no Haunt up on him, so he can't be in any fight. They're gonna TP out, they can't actually allow themselves to take Roshan once it spawns up.
Ah, there's the movement. Juggernaut. Oh. No way to go through the immunity. And hello, Roshan. How quick can you get their Team Empire to have a look at it?
But it was a very needed engagement. You can just see how determined Sumail was to have something happen. Mm-hmm. Ran straight into a Necromicon Beastmaster, knowing that full well that he had Raw up and he did not care whatsoever. When he turned around and about to Raw him, he just yulled himself.
EG's well aware of the movement of Empire coming down to Roshan. That Observer Ward is really paying dividends for them. The question is, can they do anything with it?
I think they can. Defusal up on Artesi now. Sumail closing in on that Octarine Core. Once he gets that and there's a Sivas on the dark side, it's actually surprising, or not surprising, but it's actually very difficult for Empire to push in.
They trigger that Necro very early on. Artesi's moving over. He's got 8, 9 seconds. That's too long. Like, Spectral Haunt's way too long. Artesi needs to buy space, and they are going to find one. Nice EMP tornado up. They catch Gosix up on the hillside. They slip and burn him out completely, but Gosix will drop down as the Prize of Universe, however. And Yoku, well, they're still fighting here inside the pit. OD's the man with the Agency Mortal, and that immunity BKB triggered goes after PPD. He'll frostbite up, and all does is just stop Yoku from actually stealing more and more intel. Fiat, the Gosix, buys him a moment, but a moment too less. He'll drop. Artesi made a break for the mid lane, but he won't get much more.
Aloha Dance may very well have been the sole reason they actually won that team fight. And while it looked dominant, it was because he hexed Universe right away as Universe was about to unleash the combo of Darkseer, meaning that Universe would just die instantly to the Finger of Death and the Omnislash. And then afterwards, as Spear was about to roll away, he followed up with the Impale. Great Lion play.
And Team Empire now in a position, you said before, like with all the ultis down, they had a chance!
Oh.
It's an Aegis the Immortal though, is all this blowing. But it keeps the Team Empire push coming. The Pipe also just flew in for the Beastmaster. So then again, he's not there. He's back at base. Gosix takes some time to get there.
Lacking power on FN, so they're fully determined to seize the base.
Oh, they come out. FN gonna BKB very early. No Omni Slice to Marvel. Need to buy a little bit more space here. And there goes Universe once again, evaporating quickly. Arteezy trying to get in the middle of the fight, but these BKBs is allowing Team Empire to keep the fight going until Yoku. Here's one more wear out. A defensive imprisonment protects him, at least from the call, but it's all where the blink out. He does it again. Imprisonment balance is still going to keep going. Arteezy so low on life. Here the Ghost Emperor again. They are finding a couple of kills on the back of Samael. Beastmaster can't escape himself out of this fight. Even with his Necro units continuously fighting out, he will end up dropping down. Will Samael survive? You've still got the Chen army here. PPD is also quite low, but they do not have the stuns available.
It's the old cliche of overstaying your welcome, and that's exactly what Empire did. Chen had plenty of opportunities to send home the OD, but chose not to. I don't know if it was the call to turn around and fight or what it was, but they definitely misplayed that. And of course, Sumail on the Invoker just punishing them. High level Invokers can just do that once they reach this stage of critical mass in both level and, more importantly, the items. Aghanim Scepter, Octarine Core. These two things are the worst.
Well, only if you're Team Empire.
I speak on behalf of every Dota player who doesn't play Invokers. This is the worst.
Man.
So yeah, great fight yet again from EG, hanging in there, staying in the game. And this itemization from Empire might turn out to potentially bite them in the ass with the Black King bar up on the Juggernaut instead of so many other items. And normally, you know, going a Black King bar is almost never a bad idea, but in this particular case, it may just be. But the reason he did that is because he wants to be the one that frontlines hitting on buildings.
Well, he
without
has
them.
To be.
Yeah, exactly. And actually, Universe didn't get off a Wall of Replica. Well, he got it off, but it didn't really hit anything. The only target that was copied was the Chen.
He doesn't really get that much out of that. But OD, I love it when you see ODs do this kind of stuff, and it definitely gives more meaning as well to FN's BKB.
Look at PPD's gold, though.
You go for the moonshot instead.
He got two kills in that fight, got off a great freezing field. He's 15 now, sitting on 3,600 gold.
Yeah.
So,
goodbye, PPD. He just gave the same amount of gold he got for his kills back again. And Beastmaster also picked up the Spectre in the meantime.
Alongside the Lion, yeah, that
two
combo
big
is just
kills.
It's a safe kill on anything. Regardless of how much HP you have and how late in the game it is, you're gonna die if you run into that.
It's kind of funny too when you look at it, because Ghostix, like, normally for the Blink Dagger over on the Beastmaster, but because Aloha got here so early on and now has managed to transition himself into that Aether Lens, like, that range initiation is so good. The only thing they're lacking at the moment is a creep wave. So forcing into this melee racks is a little bit more difficult. Both heroes of EG do have buyback available, but Aloha starts his initiation over. There's no Omni Slash, so again, they're going in very deep here, Empire. You're underneath tier 4 towers, and you still haven't taken out the racks. You have forced them out to walk all the way back to base. The kicks from Fear can't reach out far enough. And it looks like Empire will be backing out. Aloha being initiated on. He needs more heal, but it's just not enough. They burn through his life basically two, maybe even three times over. But now maybe here comes Empire looking for that fight into the Earth Spirit. The spin from FN can't keep up again. They still haven't taken out the ranks, and now Arteezy haunts in. Reality's forward. He defuses over on Yoka, so it's difficult for him to escape. But even FN caught underneath this freezing field. FN will go down. Team Empire, they're losing player after player, and Samael wants to keep the pressure on into the Alacrity with the call snap, spins him up towards the air, and he'll die shortly after. That's also a gem being lost from Team Empire. This is the perfect way to describe a disaster for Team Empire.
Still didn't get the racks. They went so deep for the kill on Sumail, realizing that he was the only thing standing between them and a win. But the thing is, first of all, he could buy back. So diving in that deep for him only could spell disaster, right? Because they potentially gave away three kills if they had actually committed to him full out. They didn't. They went through, but the cost was them not getting a Rex. And then the extended fight allowed EG to just turn around and fight. And that's what EG does best. Like, these players are all so high-skilled individually that they're gonna fight better than you.
And Yoku, that's just a little too easy to get out. Finger of Death's available. I really try and kill off Samael. They don't have enough damage. Universe on the run out. Again, this BKB burned of the OD. He's down to a 5-second duration on this. They play a lot more defensively, sending him back to base through the power of the Chen. And again, they look towards this mid. Another blink, Yule Scepter, initiation of the Lion. Fear capitalized with the perfect kick and then pull. Lying for now, this tier 2 tower to drop. Lying does have buyback, but it's Empire who are currently being attacked on both mid as well as top lane.
And you just see the gold gain coming in on EG right now. Fear's now, he got that ghost set earlier. He's now sitting on 3600 gold. So PPD is almost picking up a Lotus Orb. So Mail is already out of control. He doesn't even need another item, but he's sitting on almost 5k gold. Shiva's up on Universe. They have everything they need to actually win this game and turn it around in their favor now.
Dire's middle tower. And Team Empire batten down the hatches. You had the lead for so long. It was a 7k gold advantage. And now they're swung back the way of EG to about 3,000 their way. The experience swung a lot more. It was also about 3.5k. Now EG, they're knocking on the door of 10k. And the Lotus Orb, as you said, it is now done for the Crystal Maiden. Bottom lane, well, that Juggernaut too quick. And again, no stuns.
It's just such a narrow line to walk with some of these momentum-based lineups that need to execute their push at a certain time. If they give away one kill, that might ruin the entire strategy. And that's sort of what happened first with the pickoffs at the Rose Pit. Luckily, Roshan didn't spawn, EG didn't really get it, but it gave EG enough momentum to finish up a few critical items. It gave them enough time to move around on the map and farm up, for instance, the Octarine Core and the Invoker.
Mm-hmm.
And then they didn't really man up and push down that middle lane when they had the opportunity to.
Yeah, instead it was just that subtle poke and hope you can find one hero out. Just like they're looking towards the mid lane. A low armor go for the Sun Arteezy, and well, here comes your attack from Arteezy. He was saving this double damage rune, and a low armor dance is getting carved apart. Again, the heals from Empire trying to keep the line alive, but just won't be enough. Universe with another two-man back wall. They need to find the opening, and FN moves forward. He only catches up, but it's just going to be returned thanks to the Lotus Orb attack. He just throws him in deeper, but the damage still there from Empire, or is it? The Magnetize turns on FN. He needs to stay on those front lines. They're sending the Lion back. He'll be picked up by the Tornado, and that'll actually dispel. He'll fall and die at the same time. And now also with the TP out, Yoku, he gets there in time. Two heroes lost, potentially three. You've still got Samael fighting in, but he's kind of on his lonesome. They don't see him, however. The gem was not recovered by Empire, so they cannot track down the Ghost Walk Invoker.
All in all, a decent trade for Empire. The only thing they lose is the Lion twice. So it's a dieback on him, but they do get the Spectre in return, which makes it worth it for them. So Mail, though, doing just about whatever he pleases.
Ah, that Hawk sees him. Yes, Hawk still sees him. They know he's on the hillside, but where's your detection? Necrobulks are 25 seconds away. There's no sentry wards. They know exactly where he moved to, and now with the TP out, they can't reach him for a stun of control. They walk too far down to try and grab him, so Samael will escape.
Peter pushing top. Crystal Maiden, known for her split push ability. A strong little rat.
That is so not the case. You need heroes like Lina for the quick split push and the waterfall burst damage. Alright, that Hawk's gonna time him out at possibly, well, not the worst time. They've still got another Hawk Team Empire. So they'll see when Roshan instantly spawns up.
I mean,
which
Empire
is
definitely not down and out. It takes one fight where they get the proper initiates and targets locked down. For instance, killing Sumail twice would be a way of winning the game right there and then. They have items that they need on their cores. See, Juggernaut sitting on 6,000 gold. Bodhi has the Moonshot sitting on 4,500 gold, has a cheese as well, so he can keep himself alive throughout a fight.
There's your FN Basher, so spending some of that money you're talking about. Samael trying to inch himself over.
And it's good, right, because once Juggernaut gets that Blink Dagger and finishes up on Abyssal Blade, he'll actually be able to just blink in and take down Samael.
Smokes are breaking. They realize that FN's gonna run in, and the blink's away from EG. Tornado gonna try and create some space, but all it grabs the Wild Wing, and there is your blink roar over on Samael. He's gonna die so quickly. Even if the Chen's taking out the back part of the fight, you've still got your hand at God of Babylon. PPD stunned up. The Omni Slash is all over Universe. The buybacks have arrived, but it's all too late to have any real effect here. And Arteezy, he's lucky to actually TP himself out. Now they recover the Gem Team Empire, as well as claiming Roshan, Aegis, and Cheese into their hands. This is now their second cheese as well. Yoku was still holding on to one, and he's actually given it over to the Chen.
Yeah, so that was actually exactly what needed to happen for Empire. They forced the, or they didn't even force the buyback. So maybe just bought back, thinking maybe we should fight again. No such go though, as the three support heroes from EG is down and Narcisse is forced to TP out. Aegis is up on Empire, and this might just be the window they've been waiting for, especially because now Sumail needs to play it very, very carefully.
Yeah, that buyback window being locked for 6 minutes and 16 seconds.
It isn't Juggernaut that has the Aegis though, so he can't really allow himself to pick up that relic right now. But if he did, he could essentially just blink in and go all in together with the Lion or the Beastmaster or even the OD. That could then BKB up, obviously, and then focus Sumail to death. And yep, that would essentially, it should win them the game unless they get team wiped by the Spectre.
I'm also wondering why they didn't pick up the second cheese. They're still sitting back inside the Roche pit.
Can't have too much cheese.
Like, it's pretty easy to carry it. It's like, Sumail now TP's himself back off that top lane. Instantly after he ball back, like, he realized there's no point coming to the fight. So you push in that top lane and force Empire to worry. Yoku jumps forward again. There's your BKB throughout the ulti, but the Yule's dodge. Sumail will end up surviving through it. Universe has ball back, defensive imprisonment. From OD once again, the kick a little bit too early there from Fear, but they still keep sending him up. A support support from Ghostix, and they found Sumail. This could be big. The back is in. Sumail's down for almost 2 minutes. Empire, they're looking so good here to take game number one. They just need a finish it out at the moment. Fear, where is that pull? The Lotus Orb is down, him protecting him for the moment, but FN, the physical damage, it should be enough. PPD getting destroyed by Yoku. He's got 65 stolen intelligence. He's hitting like an absolute truck. A triple kill for him. They'll find Arteezy as well. Keep the damage coming. Just keep the intel being stolen. 85 now over on that OD. They've already finished up the top rack. They'll finish up the mid. A great back wall, but it really feels like too little, too late. Arteezy still trying to chase down here onto a low hard end. The kick just off target, but they still will kill off the Lion. The chance down as well, but the Omni Slash going to work, lost inside the illusions of the Spectre. And maybe now it's time for Empire to get the hell out. Yoku comes back to life again. Remember, he loses all of that stolen intelligence. He's back to square one, but Arteezy hecked up pretty quickly. Yoku's got that BKB up. Now it's actually going to time out again. But Empire, they got what they came for. Now they just have to get out without losing another core.
Yeah, they got three racks. They picked off Sumail. He still won't.
Are they going in again? They're going in again.
Yeah, there's no, that's 30 seconds on Invoker. There's no ultimates up on EG. They might as well end it. Look at the gold on the Empire lineup right now. 7,000 gold on Juggernaut. He made 4k gold in that team fight.
And it's a huge swing going the way of Empire. FM, BKB TPing out. They don't have enough damage to kill him. The melee racks drop to half life. He'll regenerate. Ghostix needs to blink again. Arteezy's not finding the right target. Even with the drum's movement speed, he cannot catch up, or can he? Dagger is too far off. Yoku's already run himself away. And maybe now they can actually start to munch on some dairy delectables.
Nothing short of a miracle needs to come out of Sumail and the rest of EG for them to actually get back into this game.
They came pretty close to it. Like, Universe got a couple of great vac walls with the kicks coming in from Fear, but there's just no scary follow-up AoE damage. Even with Arteezy, with all the farm that he's got, like, it's just not that intimidating to Team Empire when they've got the items to defend themselves.
It's definitely not impossible with the lineup that EG has, especially because they can, if they do get the lockdown on some of these targets, either the OD or the Juggernaut, they will most likely go down in the team fight. The problem is then just that they can actually buy back and It'll be a while before
PPD
EG can interface.
He is now dead. Easy 20 intel as well, and Fear, or the Raw. It was starting out from Ghostix, a little bit too far away. The Sunstrike's keeping the vision as well. Probably ensuring they also cancel any kind of blink daggering heroes of Team Empire that might still be chasing.
Beastmaster also sitting on 5,000 gold. Refresh Orb coming out on the OD now.
Wow. That's
no buyback though.
That is true. It does leave a window of opportunity, but you're still two Rakdos up. To have double hexes, your double BKBs.
Yeah, it's really the double BKB. Ultis. There's zero response to that other than Artisi fighting into him, which is risky for so many reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Sumail tried farming that Lincoln Spear in time, he didn't make it. He has the Recipe and the Perseverance on the Courier, but he's only got 1300 gold, so he's 800 shy of it. That was really the only way that he could live through either the Abyssal Blade or the Primal Roar.
Here they go. Spectre starts off with a Haunt. Where do you want a reality to at the moment? Not really anywhere. The MP Tornado taking a large amount of the mana away here from Team Empire, especially that Beastmaster. These Necrobooks are already on the field. Another back. There's no instant follow-up. They're looking for the kill on the Juggernaut, but at least they bait out the BKB, leaving the Spectre Mantra Illusions to keep the fighting going on the front lines. Aloha Dance, Finger of Death is off cooldown. Look for his nuke damage as Sphere jumps in. Turns on the Magnetize, but Yoku, he's there. Drops the ulti number one. Someone's still a little bit more intelligent before he drops number two. The refresher. Okay, who cares? He dropped it anyway. So Mal will find himself a double kill. So the OD is on the sidelines, but you're up against Megas. Headband's in the middle of the fight, and there really is only so much damage EG can do. In fact, they can't do any more of it. Triple kill and GG. Empire will take game one, 34-33, up against EG in this best of three.
In an actually very close fought game, I think both teams actually played really well. Surprised with it, how well Empire messed this early on. We saw them for a week ago in their first official game playing up against Na'Vi. Yep. Is this the return of CIS Dota? Are they back?
Well, they were very depressed about it during Shanghai that none of the CIS teams were able to really claim themselves a top position. And, well, Team Empire, that's one way to do it. And I'm really interested to see what the panel thinks about this, primarily because they went in and I know Blitz was saying, like, you have to look at EG as the better team. I'm wondering if they actually feel like Team Empire is stepping up to the plate.
They definitely played well. I will